Welcome to Cross and Crown Radio. This is Mike Robinson, your host, and I got a special guest tonight. This man has been really a blessing to me and my ministry and so many others across the country and the world. He really focuses on reaching out to atheists and disproving Darwinism. His name is Nephilim Free, or Evan, if you want to call him by his first name. He's on the front lines as an evangelist, public speaker, and debater. That's one thing that's really great about Evan. He debates any comers. He's actively engaging atheists and believers in the public arena and on YouTube. And like I said, he's a tremendous debater. Welcome, Evan. It's so good to have you tonight.
Well, thank you so much, Mike. It's a blessing to me to talk with you and to be a part of your ministry in any way. I think that's just that's wonderful. Thank you so much. Yeah,
it's our first meeting, so I'm really glad to really meet you because I feel I know you after watching so many of your videos. I really enjoy – the one thing I really enjoy about you, Evan, among many things – I mean, it's not just one thing. And I'm just being honest, so if it sounds like flattery, it's not. I'm just being honest. Is that you don't take bluff from the atheists. If they play their games or try to do their crazy antics, you still go straight towards the truth and the facts.
Well, you know, atheists have lots of games that they play, and they try to pit Christians against other Christians so that they get them arguing with each other and debating about Christian doctrines to turn on each other. They'll bait and switch. They have bait and switch tactics. They use what's called straw man arguments all the time. Mm-hmm. And a straw man argument, for anybody who's listening and doesn't know what that is you misrepresent what somebody believes or what they say, and then you attack it and allegedly shoot it down to make it look like you've defeated them in some way, but what you're attacking is not actually what they believe or what they've said. So it's a trick. And so they have all kinds of tactics that they play. They employ straw man arguments an awful lot. They'll straw man a Christian into the dirt if they can get away with it. But I do tend to catch them at their games and cut them right out of it. I've noticed a lot of people, when they debate atheists, they let the atheists get by with too much. They'll pull things over on the Christian, and it just gets right by. But I try not to let that happen. I like to nip it, as old Barney Fife would say, nip it in the bud. As soon as it starts up, I try to nip it right in the bud.
And that's why I really recommend to a lot of my friends and other folks out there your debate videos, because of that's a very powerful feature of your ministry that, like you said, unfortunately a lot of people don't understand that, and the Christians just allow the atheists to kind of control and keep throwing the straw men's machine gun all their false ideas and just let it go. But you don't, and I notice you always call them back to where the subject you're talking about, because they want to get off the subject and you call them back to that. I imagine that must be something you really have to focus on.
Well, as I've said, they have all the tactics. They've got all their pockets are full of tactics, and it takes knowing the arguments. Is that there's a couple of things that you have to do if you're going to be effective in debating and refuting atheists and evolutionists. Is first you have to understand what they believe. You've got to know what they say they believe, and then you've got to know the refutations to what they believe and the responses that they'll pull up on you about the things that you believe. So it's not something that you can just jump into and become effective at by just any old Christian. And I'm not saying that to try to puff myself up. I'm just saying anybody could be a solid Christian apologist, because we have the truth, and the truth can't be refuted no matter what the argument is brought against it. So, but you have to familiarize yourself with a lot of things, and the more knowledge that you have about a subject, the more effective you'll be, because that's when you can snap it and nip it right in the bud. But as soon as they bring up something, and they won't get by with you on it.
That's a powerful truth. Most Christians don't realize that they know they have the truth. They affirm it, profess it, but they don't, when they discuss it with atheists, they don't discuss it in the sense of knowing that. And you do, and that's really refreshing.
It's I don't color code things. I don't put icing on anything. I'll just tell an atheist straight up, I have the truth. You know, what I'm telling you is the truth, whether you believe it or like it or not. I mean, there are certain truths. There is objective truths, and I have it. And that really kind of gets under their skin because they don't like being told straight up. They want to make it look like, it's debatable. Like, I can make their worldview seem questionable. No, you can't.
Yeah, they like playing games.
You think you can, but you can't.
Yeah. They like playing games, and they want it to look like, well, you have your side and we have our side, and so let's just trade facts for facts. But they have no facts on their side, and they have no truth on their side.
That's exactly right. They do want to make it look like there's so much validity to what they have to say that really it's a contest as to who's the better debater or who knows the most or who has the slickest arguments or the quickest response. And the truth is they just don't have anything on their side, nothing. And so you're right about that. They do attempt to make it look like there's legitimacy to their worldview, and so we can really debate. Hey, I can corner you. No, you can't. There's no truth in what you have to say.
You're so right. And so your name is very fascinating. For some folks that don't know the Old Testament, they may have no idea where your name comes from. Nephilim Free. Could you give us a little background on that? Is that just something? How did you come across that name? Because it's a great, catchy name, and that's where you want to go, folks, at his YouTube channel.
Well, it's kind of a curious story as to how I came up with that name. Before I became, I don't know why, but I've always believed that Jesus Christ was the truth. Since I was a small child. Maybe it was because I was brought up as a Christian. My family wasn't a particularly Bible thumping or church going family, but everybody in my family was a Christian, a believer. And so I've always believed, I don't know, somehow, maybe because God got a hold of me by the ear when I was a little boy and said, follow me, son. I don't know, but I always somehow at any age in my life can remember that for some reason I have always believed that Jesus Christ was the truth. And I think that's the work of the Holy Spirit. But then in my 40s, I was in my early 40s, late 30s to early 40s, God really started pulling on me and saying, you're not living right, and I want you to change. I want you to change your thinking, and I want you to be a Christian. And I think that he drew me to him. The scriptures tell us, no man comes unto the Son unless drawn by the Father. So at that time, I was investigating the religions of the world historically and things related to that. And I learned about the demonic forces in the world. I really didn't have a clue as to how strong the demonic forces are in the world and how effective they are and how prevalent their work is and how active they are. Mm-hmm. And I came to, and then I began to study what Christians had been writing, articles I was reading on the internet about the Nephilim. And I found that fascinating. And I really, at this point, wasn't a creationist. I had been indoctrinated to believe in evolution and brainwashed like so many people. When I was 42 years old, I believed in evolution. Because, the university professors all say it's true, so many.
Yeah.
And so, and then I got to reading what Christians had to say about the angels that kept not their first estate, Jude 1 and whatnot, in Genesis, the sons of God came unto the daughters of men and bare giants. And all the evil, and I said, really, the Bible talks about this? Because I hadn't really read the Bible. And so I go to the books in the Bible, and I start looking up the word giants in the King James Bible. And I find giants, 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 giants everywhere at Jericho. They're here, they're there, the Hittites, the Philistines. Giants everywhere in the Bible, and God was at war with the giants. Mm-hmm. He had told the Israelites, to eliminate those people from the land that he had given them because they were evil. And I came to realize that these sons of the angels, they seem to be the sons of the angels that kept not their first estate. Oiketerion is the Greek word in Jude 1. And I realized that these beings had powerful influence in the world. And I think one of the things that God did to draw me to this understanding was because I became fascinated with the whole UFO phenomenon. And I began investigating that. I read dozens upon dozens upon dozens of web pages where people give their own personal testimony about being abducted or encountering a UFO, seeing a UFO, this kind of thing. And I filtered them. I thought, okay, well, that one's probably a whack nut. No, this guy probably uses drugs. But this one, now that seems legit. Something is going on. And there has to be some truth to this because that many people can't be saying that you had some kind of encounter and there'd be no truth to it. It's just not plausible. So I started, what is this UFO phenomenon? And I think God used that. I think God saw in me, said, got something I can hook Evan with. Now I got something I can use to make him intensely and curious about something. And God led me to come to the understanding that this whole UFO phenomenon is really about the angels that kept their state. It's really a demonic. There are no alien beings from some other world, organic organisms that have come here in spaceships. That's not the truth. The truth is that these beings abdicated their holy estate, and they were cut off from God and damned for what they had done to corrupt mankind and to work in the world to do evil. And that's the actual basis for the UFO phenomenon. And so so I realized, wow, these Nephilim are big players in the Bible. This is a big theme. It's all throughout the Old Testament. And so I thought to myself, well, as God continued to draw me to himself and make me into a Bible-thumping believer, I realized that lots of the lies in the world and many of all the false religions and all of this is nothing more than lies from Satan, how he has twisted the world at attempting to steal souls from God and turn man away from God. And I realized that that Christ saves someone from all of that, not only from their sin, but he can open their eyes to all of this and make them and save them from the works of the enemy. And I realized these Nephilim were part of the enemy, and so I declared myself free of the evils of the Nephilim by calling myself Nephilim free, like sugar free. Free of the Nephilim, so I'm sugar free, but I am Nephilim free because I have been freed from the works of the angels and what they could have done to my soul, what they were doing to my soul, and what they might have as the ultimate result of my soul by the blood of Jesus Christ. And so I called myself.
That makes a lot of sense because I was really involved in the UFO stuff too before I was a Christian. I was raised as a non-believer, all my family real nice but unbelievers, and so I came to faith at age 19. But before I was 19, I was big into UFOs. Once I got saved, I came to the same conclusion you did, that these things have to be spiritual. There's too many of them out there just to be, you know, there's nothing out there at all, right? Obviously, some of them are phony, but there's some real and one fact, I don't know if it's still the case, was that in the 80s and the early 90s, at that point, there was never a confirmed born-again believer taken and abducted.
Really?
Yeah. I don't know if that's still the case. I haven't researched that recently.
Interesting.
But, yeah. So that's one reason why I was thinking, this has got to be spiritual.
Right. Now, yeah, it is. Absolutely.
Now, Evan, what do you think are the main spiritual needs of the West? When I say the West, I don't mean the West of the United States, but the West in the sense of America, Europe, and so forth. What do you think with what's going on?
Well, you know, people ask me sometimes, Christianity is on the, you know, demise, you know, it's going downhill, you know, so much for your God, right? I hear atheists say this kind of thing. And I think some Christians have this false belief that there's going to be this giant revelation, regeneration, and the church is just going to become prominent and we're going to take over the world. That's not what the Bible says. I'm sorry. The Bible says we're going to be persecuted right to the end. Mm-hmm. And when Christ returns, then he will put the nations under his feet. and he will make the world his footstool, and he will take control. But we are not going to do it. We are winning the battle, the individual, for the individual in the spirit, in that we win, in that we get eternal life through the blood of Jesus Christ. Individually, we win, but we're not winning the world. We can help God with the Holy Spirit to help draw people to the truth, and that's the purpose of debate, is for people to be able to see that I can refute the atheist and the evolutionist so they don't have the truth, and this Christian guy has done that. Maybe he's got the truth. Maybe I should listen to him, and maybe his God is the truth, and maybe I should become a Christian. That's the purpose of debate, to undo the damage that the evil ones are doing in the world.
Is that what basically got you involved in apologetics ministry? Because there's a lot of apologists out there, and I know there's a lot of folks doing pretty good work. But like you said, I think a lot of them, unfortunately, are so mild and kind of get trampled over when they're discussing these issues with hardcore unbelievers.
Yeah, and it comes, I think, from well, I'll answer that, but first – I didn't really fully answer your question. What can we do? What can the West do? I think what would be ideal would be that the West returns to its Christian values that it had in the late Middle Ages, you know, before the Enlightenment, as they call it, and before the secular thinking and socialist thinking and secular humanism saw its powerful rise in the 1600s, 1700s. And I think part of the reason for that is because Christians outsourced their academics to non-believers, to pagans, deists, and ultimately atheists. Yeah. It was a lack of effort by Christians that caused the demise of Christianity in Europe. For example, I wouldn't say it's over with in Europe. Christianity is still strong there. But we have seen that the nations of Europe have become extremely secularized, and many atheism has risen severely there. And that's because of the ineffective and lazy absence of participation and activity of the Christians in Europe in those 15, 16, 1700s, they let people who were non-believers take over important areas of the world like academics, and they've used that to their advantage. So, but what we could do is return to those Christian moral values that Europeans strongly stood for in 1500 AD that has fallen away from. I don't know how to accomplish that, because I don't think that we're actually ever going to, unfortunately. I think the thing we can do is to help God bring certain souls to Christ, be a tool for him to use. And the rest is in his hands. We can trust him, because God knows certainly what he's doing, and he's going to have his way with the world, and his justice will prevail. We can always trust that God will prevail, and he's kind of come out shining, and the enemy will be in chains.
That's a good point. I've always noticed you seem very gracious in how you discuss other Christians and such. And yet, hopefully, a lot of the Christians, and there are brothers and sisters, but they're too mild and too sweet and sugary. If they could get a little backbone when they discuss these issues and not take a bunch of the nonsense that the atheists and the New Agers, as well as perhaps some folks in Islam, try to throw at them. Because like you said at the start of the broadcast here, we have the truth.
Absolutely. Imagine a situation like this. Let's say that a fellow and his lady are in a restaurant, just a fast food restaurant maybe, and there's a couple of atheists sitting at a table, and the Christian lady is wearing a crucifix around her neck or something, and the atheists are getting loud, and they say something, mocking Christianity is a way of, because they want the Christians that are present to hear, you know, and they put some false argument forth, you know, like, that Jesus, he's just one more myth, you know. How many death and resurrection stories are in the ancient Greeks and the Babylonians? Jesus is just one more of those guys. As if the Christians know they got the truth. And most Christians would just say, honey, just ignore them, you know, forget them. Mm-hmm. And they would go about their dinner. Not me. Right. I would. I would turn to the atheist and say, oh, you really think so? Well, I'm sorry, but if you would investigate, you would find there are no death and resurrection myths in the ancient world. There are none. And those that did come to existence took place 2 to 3 centuries or 4 centuries after Jesus Christ. So it seems like you've come to believe a lie. How about that? And then I would turn back and go back to eating my sandwich. I would shut them down right on the spot. And I think more Christians ought to be able to do that if they could. I think I think that would just be a good thing.
I think I saw you use that on one or two videos, and it blew the minds of the atheists or the skeptics who I forget who they were that you were discussing. But you mentioned that truth about the so-called myths of the dying and rising saviors. And they were blown away. Their jaws dropped. They didn't know what to say. They thought, here's one more easy thing to throw. And I've noticed that you tend to answer almost all their questions because you do a lot of research and you tell people to study. But once in a while, when they have something, you admit that you'll do some investigation and get back to them, which I think is a real key. In other words, no man can know every single thing.
Right.
But yet we should be bold and so forth. You know, with the popular apologetics, what truths do you think have been most effective in your debates? What truth that you press on, say, the atheist or evolutionist and so forth?
Well, I think there's a couple of really powerful arguments that just knock atheism out. Atheists really can't stand it when you bring these up because they see the rationale in it and the logic, but they're going to deny it. Mm-hmm. And one of them is that the universe requires a prime mover. It requires an uncaused cause, and in fact, a personal one. Time, energy, space, and matter are infinite or interdependent. All of them require each other. And the cause for every physical thing in this universe has a prior cause. This is the law of causality. Every material thing in the universe requires a cause. You can't make an exception for the universe and say the universe is uncaused. It, too, had a cause. Now, since the universe is time, energy, space, and matter, something had the power to bring time, energy, space, and matter into being. This, by necessity, means that it's not it's immaterial. It's eternal. It doesn't degrade. Scripture tells us, God says, I change not. Says in the Old and New Testament, I don't change. But the universe decays. It's moving downhill, second law of thermodynamics. So this cause is unchanging and eternal and infinite. And it's even personal because it chose to create something instead of letting nothingness ensue indefinitely. So we have that's one. Also, the fact that all life is prescribed by information, the DNA molecule. It's been science has discovered that there's a package of a four-dimensional, actually, package of information in every cell of an organism that prescribes the entire organism. It's a recipe for how to make a human being or a giraffe or a field mouse. And that information is linguistic and it operates algorithmically. Information, linguistics, and algorithms are products only of an intelligence. So this is an empirical, logical argument that every living organism in the world was designed by an unfathomably great intelligence. And that points us directly to God. So that's another. And then, of course, there's the ontological argument about objective moral values. Atheists will say, well, there is no objective moral values. There are no rules, no set of things that we ought and ought not do. It's all determined by our own humanistic opinions. Man's opinion is what determines what is morally right or wrong. There's no objective moral values because if they understand that if objective moral values and duties did exist, then this points directly to a God. But the truth of it is then it's easy to shoot them down about that because all you have to ask them is a question that causes them to admit objective values and duties do exist, such as, is it ever justifiable to torture an infant for pleasure?
Right.
And no atheist will ever say yes because they'll make themselves out to be a psychopath if they did. So they tend not to answer that question. You ask them that question, you don't get a response, they're off on something else. Because they know that if they answered the question, then they've just acknowledged there is a moral objective value that exists that is not based on people's opinions. And so proving that objective moral values and duties do exist is another. So we have and then there's one more that I would point out, is that if we compare all the religions of the world, Christianity is the only possibly yeah. true religion, because God says in his word that of course, he's going to stomp out evil. He's going to expunge his creation of evil in the end. And so God requires death for sin. The wages of sin is death, the scriptures say. But in Islam, for example, God can just say, oh, well, you know, I forgive you. Because I'm merciful, I forgive you. But the Christian God can't do that. He has there is a penalty of death, and it will be paid. Yeah. And Jesus Christ paid that death price for us. So the God of the Bible is absolutely holy, because he's a maximal being. He doesn't just say, I can just forgive you and forget about my sense of justice. You know, but the God of the Bible says, no, my justice will be levied. There will be death for your sin, but I can forgive you. Only way I can forgive you is because of the death. You will die, but somebody's going to die, but I can fix it. I have fixed it so it doesn't have to be you. I will do it in your place. And that's how God remains holy, because he doesn't cast off his justice. The Muslim God says, I don't have to levy the penalty of death for your sin. I can just forgive it instead. But the God of the Bible says, no, there will be a sentence of death. Somebody's going to die for your sin, but I love you and forgive you because I will take that upon myself. So if we compare all the religions of the world, they're all works-based.
Yes.
Where people make themselves better. Even Buddhism, which is a philosophical religion, not a theistic one, you know, it's all a self-help program, you know, where you purge yourself of evil, and it's all about what you do. But in Christianity, it's not about anything that you do except believe upon Christ. He does all of it for you. So if we compare the religions of the world, there's only one religion which has an all-powerful, maximal, absolutely holy and just being who doesn't have to cast off his sense of justice in order to forgive somebody. It has to be a penalty of death, and he's made a way for that penalty not to be put on you. So we find in Christianity the only God in any religion in this world that is absolutely maximal and absolutely just and complete being, because he has complete justice and complete grace. He doesn't have to throw away one or the other to be God. And so this means, logically, Christianity has the only potential true God. So no religion in this world has the potential to be true except Christ. That argument has really, I think, shut the mouths of a lot of people lately that I've been debating. They don't know where to go with that, because they're like, I don't know how to handle that. And I brought that up with Muslims, and the Muslims that I've used this argument for, you know what happens? They just get very angry and start yelling at me.
Yeah.
Because they see the truth in my argument, the logic of it is sound, and it makes them very angry, and they don't know how to account for it. They can't account for it, because it proves that their religion does not have a maximal being in it as God. It's some underling being or lesser being, but it could possibly be a demigod, but he can't be God. And that makes them very angry, and they don't know how to deal with it except start yelling at you and frothing at the mouth.
Out of the thousands and thousands of religions out there, the Christian faith is the only one that is grace-based, and God is still just. There's no other one, which is a powerful truth itself. I mean, you would think, well, somebody else would get it right, you know, but yet the law is written on man's heart, so all the religions that come forth from man's heart are going to be law-based, works-based. Christianity came from revelation from God, so it's grace-based, yet God is just. That's really powerful. I love watching you press that on folks, because they're not used to hearing that. They think Christianity is just one of the other options out there.
Right. That's the secular myth that, you know, Christianity is, there may be some truths in it, but hey, there's truths in Muslims, and there's truth. The Buddhists have some truths too. No, they don't. They have Gnosticism. That's what they've got, the philosophy. And the scripture warns us about that. Beware lest any man should probably can't quote it correctly. Essentially, it says, don't let people fool you with their vain philosophy and deceit after the rudiments of the world, not after Christ, Jesus Christ. Mm-hmm. So that's what the world, the game of the world is, and that is what they do. They do try to make it look like, well, you just have one more religion. No, well, I have the truth. There is a truth. We can get at that truth. If there is a truth, it's presented to us in such a way that we can know the truth. We can actually know the truth.
And who in the world is like Jesus? Here, Jesus is the one with all the evidence. I've heard you many times talk about the prophetic evidence Christ has. He alone has all the evidence. He alone died on the cross for our sins. He alone God raised from the dead. He alone spoke like no one else ever spoke. He alone did the miracle he did. He alone loved like nobody else did. He alone split BC into AD. Who else did that? It's all in one guy.
Absolutely. All in him. And, you know, I think one of the things I've thought about a lot as of late is how powerful the speech, the Beatitudes were. Matthew 5, I think?
Yes, sir.
Jesus spoke with complete and absolute authority to those people. And it must have been just mind-bending. Those people must have been their eyes glued on Jesus when he was talking. Because he wasn't talking like some teacher had come out of a school and, pay attention, I'm going to teach you a couple of things. No, he was talking as though God is standing right before them.
Amen.
And that kind of authority. And you know their eyes and ears were just glued to Jesus. And you won't find that kind of a speech having been uttered by the mouth of any human being in the history of the world outside of Christ.
No rabbi, no Plato, not Shakespeare, nobody. It's no interesting that the way you said that, because the Sadducees came to arrest him. And unfortunately for them, they listened to him speak for a while, and so they didn't arrest him. They went back to their leaders and they said, why didn't you arrest him? They said, no one ever spoke like this guy.
Something different about this guy.
Just blew their socks off, you know. You know, Evan, I notice you deal really well with a lot of the nasty new atheists. They seem to be having a little bit of influence on the culture. How do you respond to them, and do you have any tips for just the average Christian when he bumps up either online or in person at work or someplace, one of these kind of really belligerent, almost militant atheists out there?
Well, I think that, you know, the scriptures tell us to be prepared to give an account for the faith that is in us. And I think a lot of Christians don't do that like they ought to. And I wish more would. So I think the atheists like to, you know, they like to toss around insults about Christianity and make jokes about it right in front of Christians, too. It doesn't bother them a bit to make a joke about Christianity or God in front of people who believe in him, even church-going people. So I think the thing to do is to be prepared to give an account. If they look at you or if they say something to you, be prepared to give an account for what the faith that's in you. It's a good thing to know the Bible, but it's also a good thing to know more about your religion than just what you get when you just simply read through the scriptures. So be prepared to give an account. The way I deal with them is I just shoot down what they say. If I'm engaged in a debate with them, then I don't give them any slack whatsoever. They'll set themselves up for a fall a lot of times. They'll say, well, you can't know that. And I'll ask them, why can't I know it? Mm-hmm. Why can't I know the truth? What do you mean I can't know that Jesus Christ is the truth? What do you mean that Jesus is just one other God? How can that be true? Jesus Christ is God manifest in the flesh. What are you talking about? And they'll say, no, he's not. Somebody would say, well, I think I could make an argument that Jesus is different. I don't do that. I just say, he's God. What are you talking about? You know? Yeah. And so you be as bold as they are. And that really throws them off because they expect you to just kind of get snivelly and, well, wait a minute, I think I had some notes here somewhere that would, maybe I can defend myself against that. No, just come right out and tell them, what are you talking about? Jesus Christ is God manifest in the flesh. What are you talking about? You know, and that kind of stuns them. They're like, whoa, you know. So be bold and be confident that you have the truth, and that if you investigate it, you can refute any argument that comes towards you by anybody.
I would encourage all the Christians out there to really check out Nephilim Free's YouTube channel. If you're thinking, man, I don't feel adequate to witness this way, listen especially his debate videos. Take some notes and look at the way Evan goes about it. He's patient, but he stays online with where he's arguing. And that's what, that's one of the big tips. And get equipped by listening to some of his videos, and then you will know it. You know what? What's the deal with this Aaron Rog character who seems to kind of go after you a little bit, but seems to be afraid to debate you?
Well, Aaron Rog is arguably one of the most popular and influential atheists in the world today. He's as I understand it, he's not a scientist or an academic. He's just an atheist layperson who has heavily investigated his worldview and investigated other things because he wants to prove that God is not true and evolution is a fact. And he's very loud. He's very arrogant. And he's very outspoken. And I challenged him to a structured debate with a moderator about 10 years ago. And I have kind of prodded him about it every 2 or 3 years. You know, hey, when are we going to have this debate? You know, what are you afraid of? I mean, he comes up with lots of excuses, you know, but then he goes off and debates somebody who knows less about apologetics than me. Mm-hmm. And I think he is afraid to debate me, actually. Pardon?
I think you're right. You know, analyzing his site and your site, it just seems that he knows that this guy is not going to be just rolled over, and I don't think he has answers to your questions.
He does. He has been engaged with Christians in debate in Google Hangouts that weren't structured debates, just casual ones, and he would debate me in that way. But when I've done it with him 3 times, but not for very long. And the reason is because whenever someone like myself gets into a Hangout or Google Hangout with him, and there's always 3 or 4 other atheists present, it's always on their ground. They don't want to. Somebody like Aaron Raw won't join a Christians Hangout. He's going to require you to join one of his where he's got 4 or 5 of his friends. What happens is somebody will ask me a question. I'll say, well, okay, one way we can know that DNA is proof that intelligent design is a fact is because it possesses information, linguistics, and instantly I'm being talked over. Mm-hmm. Immediately, they can't be quiet. Aaron Raw won't be quiet. He's got to talk over me, raise his voice, and prevent me from making my argument. I'll start to give an account for something, and maybe it'll take me 10 seconds to explain it, 3 sentences to make to set it up, and then 4 or 5 more to give the account. You know, be patient and listen to me for 30 seconds. You can hear the whole argument. No, not going to do that. 8 seconds into when I'm speaking, he starts talking over me and raises his voice. Because he doesn't actually want to engage in debate, he wants to talk over and proselytize and make it look like he's winning. So this is why I've challenged him to a structured debate where he doesn't get away with that. The moderator would shut him down and say, Mr. Raw, it's not your turn to speak. You need to be quiet now. Mm-hmm. But he won't engage in that kind of debate with me, I think, because then I can make my case and make my refutations without being talked over, shut down, or spoken over, interrupted constantly. And prominent atheists can't stand that idea. So, but in some Google Hangouts, he'll take on Christians in Google Hangouts. I've seen that I didn't think were terribly well informed, but he won't do that with me in any medium except in a Google Hangout run by atheists, where he can interrupt me constantly, raise his voice, and talk over me, and not even actually allow me to finish one little argument. And it gets very frustrating. So after about 5 minutes or 10 minutes of that, I bowed out and say, Mom, look, if you want to engage in a real debate, we can have a structured one sometime, and left. I've done that like 3 times with him. But a structured debate with me, I do think he's afraid of doing it because I'll shoot down his evolutionism, and he's afraid of that, I think.
Yeah, the argument from DNA and the coding and so forth, the information there, it's just obviously so common sense. It's very, very difficult for the atheist. And in a structure debate, you get to lay it all out. And Mr. Raw doesn't get to, like you said, just yell over you so nobody can hear what you're saying.
Right.
Yeah, I think so. Mr. Raw, if you're out there and you have as much information as you think you do, here's another debate challenge. You have the opportunity, a structured debate. Okay? Let's see if he does it. I'm sure he won't, because if I were him, I'd be afraid. I wouldn't want to get publicly smashed either, you know.
Well, you know, that would crumble his, you know, that would refute his worldview in front of all his followers, and he has tens of thousands of subscribers to his social media websites, and that would be very damaging to his credo, you know, and I think he wants to prevent that kind of damage.
You know, with all the modern scientists, so many of them seem to be following Darwinism. Why do you think that's the case? And are we seeing some folks, you know, jumping off the Darwin's bandwagon these days? Or what's going on there?
Well, the world, the secular humanists were able to convince millions of people that evolution is true because they're able to package ideas in such a way that it seems logical. And anybody, for example, they can take bones, you know, from extinct apes, and then they can take them from human beings that have highly pronounced brow ridge and a very sloping forehead. And there's humans just like that walking the earth today, people that don't have much of a chin. And they can line these bones up and give the impression that evolution is true. And so people believe the storyboard, and they say, oh, so it must be true. And so because they're able to package their ideas to present them in such a way that it looks true, they've beguiled millions and millions of people with this evolution stuff. And now, unfortunately, millions of Christians even believe in evolution. That's really unfortunate. So they've been able to twist science to their advantage and use authority figures like in science, like prominent scientists that live today, Neil deGrasse Tyson, Michio Kaku, and others, and use their authority. And these men, some of these men mock God, by the way, like Neil deGrasse Tyson. He's a prominent astrophysicist. He absolutely mocks God in some of his interviews, and I just find it abhorrent. I'd love to debate him, but you know, I'm a nobody. And he's a famous scientist. He would never take that challenge. But boy, if I could just get him in an hour debate, I would love that. But so because they've been able to package false information to make it look science. Look like science, and that's how they pulled it over the wool over people's eyes. And another idea is, I think one of the biggest lies that's been put forth is not just evolution, but this lie.
Hello, did I lose you? You still there? I think
there
I lost.
Hello?
Well, there you are.
Mark?
You're back. Can you hear me now?
Yes, I hear you.
Okay, yeah. I don't know, storm outside, but keep going.
Yeah, it's probably lag. So anyway, this idea that the Earth was once a ball of magma cooling in space over millions of years, and then, of course, evolution happens after that. So in the scriptures, we find that God created the world and everything in it in six literal days. And it's absolutely clear it's six literal days because it provides the context in the evening and the morning. Mm-hmm. That means the coming and going of 24 hours.
Right.
So it's unarguable that the scriptures speak of a literal six-day creation. And even Hebraists, experts in the Hebrew language, have studied this creation account in Genesis and said the text absolutely is describing six literal days when it says God made it. It's not using allegory. It's not saying these are millions of years of time, and it's not making allegories. No, it's absolutely describing six literal 24-hour days, and we have scientific evidence that the Earth is actually created, and it was not billions of years old. We have actually a lot of scientific evidence for that. But because people believe this idea that the Earth was once a ball of magma that cooled down over millions and millions of years, then they believe there's millions of years of time in the past, and therefore you have the time that evolution would require if evolution were true. And this makes evolution seem more plausible. And so people swallow that idea that the Earth is billions of years old, and if the Earth is billions of years old, well, the Bible's got to be telling us just it's an allegory. It's not literally true. You know, God didn't really make an Adam and Eve, something. It's just a story, and it calls God's word into question and makes it tells a lie. It says that the Bible is not literally true. and we can't trust it. And so people come to believe that the Bible is using allegorical speech when it describes literal creation and whatnot. And so they'll believe that the Earth is billions of years old and evolution is true, but then maybe still be a Christian thinking, well, I don't know how God did it all, you know. Maybe, you know, it's just parables or allegories, but, you know, Jesus is still the truth. But they're compromising Christianity when they do that, and they're compromising. And they're because they don't really realize that science has actually refuted these ideas and that you can stand behind the scriptures. The scriptures have been vindicated by philosophy and science, and we have the evidence for it. They don't realize that. And I like to try to help people see that we can trust the scriptures. Here's one for you. Jesus Christ, he was asked, is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife, give up his wife for any cause? You know, what reason is there that's legitimate for a man to divorce his wife? And Jesus said to them, have ye not read that he who made them in the beginning made them male and female, and the two would become one flesh, made them male and female. So if evolution is true, Jesus Christ is a liar. He doesn't know the truth. He doesn't know what he's talking about. He's deluded. But if Jesus Christ spoke the truth, young earth creation is true. And you see, when Jesus said that, he was quoting Moses. He said, in the beginning, God made them male and female. He's quoting Moses. So he's quoting the creation account and saying God literally made an Adam and an Eve in the beginning. And not millions of years later, in the beginning.
Yeah.
And so Jesus Christ quoted the scriptures in that case and confirmed the six-day creation account in the book of Genesis for us. So we can trust the scriptures. They're true. Our Lord has told us that creation account is a fact. In fact, in the Old Testament, in Exodus, it says we're to honor the Sabbath because he told the Hebrews, honor the Sabbath for God created the world in 6 days and the seas and all that in them is. So that's confirmation that the creation account in Genesis is a literal six-day account because that's what God made. He made a work week and a day off to rest and honor God, and that's exactly what's described in Genesis as the creation account. So Christians just need to come to realize that the scriptures are correct, and if man's philosophical ideas about evolution or the history of the world or any of those things contradict the scripture is right because it's God's word and their ideas are wrong.
And there's nothing on the planet that has the evidence that scripture has by any stretch, nothing close. No holy book, no science book, nothing has the amount of evidence that it's divine origin.
Not even close.
It's not even close. Now, what do you think, Evan, that so many evolutionists have a problem with the DNA code and the information theory behind it? It seems such common sense that, you know, they look up to SETI, they want to find some information and to make sure that there's some intelligence out there in outer space, yet they won't use that same type of logical thinking in looking at the information within a DNA, within a cell, the DNA code.
Right. It's because they're looking for a way out. They're looking for anything that could be the truth except Jesus Christ. To be honest with you, atheists say, well, I'm just agnostic towards one less God than you, one more God than you. You're a Christian. I don't believe in your God. I don't believe in the Buddhist gods. I mean, the Hindu God. I don't believe in the Muslim God. So I'm just agnostic towards one more God than you. The truth is that the atheists despise Christ and they despise God. And it's Christianity that they set their sights on so much, not the rest of the world. You might hear them talk about other religions, but the one that really gets under their skin is Christianity, because I think there's a little part of them that knows that if God does exist, it's that Christian guy.
Yes.
That's the one. They already know that. They know that it, and so, but they, they're looking for a way out, and this the DNA information argument is completely irrefutable. And to counter it, what the evolutionists will do is say, well, it's not actually information in the DNA. It's not really information. It just kind of looks like information. Well, that's not really algorithms. You know, and nature can create algorithms, and even if it was, it's not really an algorithm. That's not actually linguistics, that it's in DNA. So that's their argument, is to deny that these things are actually true. Even though the science journals all describe DNA as being information, linguistics, and algorithm, because that's obviously what it is. But if you were to question one of those evolutionist scientists and say, is it actually information? Then they'll try to give an argument that information doesn't necessarily require an intelligence. The origin of information is not necessarily a mind, which is wrong. It is. The origin of all information is a mind. Always stems only and can only stem from an intelligence, same as linguistics, same with algorithms. And so they'll try to say that the informed ones will say, yeah, maybe it is, but it's not the kind you're thinking of. It's not, there's no ontology there, and it can be produced by nature, which is false. And the uninformed evolutionist atheist will say it's not actually information, algorithms, or linguistics. The reason they do that, of course, is because they know that it's true that if information, linguistics, and algorithms actually do exist in DNA, and if it's true that those things can only originate from an intelligence, that it's absolutely a fact that all living things were designed by a mind of unfathomable genius, and that they refuse to accept.
Well, that's a good way to put it. Because when you read articles, even the New York Times, Wall Street Journal, and they describe some latest find within the DNA code, they generally use language like encyclopedia, code, language. Even Bill Gates compared it to a computer code. You know, so it's there. It's so obvious. And like you said, they just don't want to face the truth because it's Jesus. And, you know, relating to Jesus, it's odd that you never hear anybody say, oh, Muhammad, when they blaspheme, or oh, Allah, or Buddha. It's always Jesus, because they know that he is the truth. There's something about him in Christianity, like you said, so they know that.
That's a very good point. Yeah, you don't hear them say expletive Muhammad or expletive Allah. No, that's always using God or Jesus Christ as their expletives. That's a very good point. Here, I'm going to say something that a lot of people won't understand. Some may not believe me, but I don't believe there is such a thing as a true atheist.
Neither do I.
I believe everyone knows God exists.
Yeah.
I believe that the human psychology and the human heart, you know, as the scripture says, the human heart is deceitfully wicked, who can know it, alluding that God only can truly know the human heart, right? So I believe that human psychology, which is partly due to a product of the human heart, you know, our motivations, our desires, our needs, wishes, and everything, and fears and hopes, is so complex and so ingeniously designed, made by God, that a person can actually build a box in their head, in their mind, and then jump inside and fold the flaps over, cut a little hole, and peek out the hole and say, there's no God out there, is there? There's really no God out there. So what they're doing is they're convincing themselves that there is no God. And part of their mind actually goes about its daily business believing there really isn't a God. I don't have anything to worry about. But if somewhere in the very depths of their soul, in their being, there is a little spark that knows for sure God does exist. And I think atheists struggle with that. They're trying to silence it. They're pouring buckets of water on that spark, wanting to shut it up and put it out. But they can't. So I believe everyone actually knows God exists. But because human psychology is so, it can be so complex, and the human, the workings of the human heart so convoluted, that they may go about their day actually thinking that they don't believe that there is a God, when the truth is, there is a part of them that absolutely knows God exists, and they try to extinguish that.
Yeah, I think you're right. I did a recent video on the scientific studies up in Finland where they took atheists and believers, and they had them either wish for something harmful to happen to themselves or a family member, or ask God to do something harmful to themselves or the family member. The atheists reacted. They were hooked up to this like polygraph machine. They reacted only when they invoked God, just like the believers. So they had the same reaction as the believers did when they invoked God to bring harm to themselves and their family, but not when they just wished it.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
Yeah.
And you'll find sometimes atheists calling God's name when trauma comes out. I'll just give you a fake scenario, just to make the point. You know, this may not be a real thing that's ever happened, but things like it do. You know, a guy pulls into a parking lot and his car is smoking and making a clunk, 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 clunk noise. And he jumps out of his car and he's an atheist and says, "Oh God, please, no." He doesn't realize he just called upon God for help. But he didn't mean it, and he's an atheist, but he's calling to God for help. You know, these kind of, you know, what they would call a Freudian slip, atheists do this frequently, and I think it's just proof that they know that somewhere down in their soul that God exists, or they wouldn't do that. If they were truly an atheist, why would they do that? Well, I don't think it's because other people do and it's a kind of a common thing. I think it's because there's a part of them that just responds immediately, "I wish God would help me." Why would you be doing that if you didn't believe in him?
Yeah, and all the atheists I've talked to, which number in the hundreds, one-on-one and one-on-two, either in person or online, I've noticed this too. And when I watch your conversations with atheists, when you kind of get in the debate, but you're getting a good conversation with them, I've noticed it almost looks like they're almost admitting emotionally that they know God exists, but they still have to hold their argument. It's kind of weird how I've seen that with some of your debates where you can tell they're just playing a game here. They can't admit they're wrong, but they know they're wrong.
Yeah, and the truth is, most of these people, they're just looking for confirmation. They're trying to get a Christian to help them confirm they have that they're safe in not believing in God. The real reason I think that atheists want to they can't, of course, refute what the Christian, the case for Christ, but they might think that they can. And what they're looking to do is to deconvert a Christian, because I think that if they could cause a Christian to stop believing in God and be converted, this would be for them some kind of, hammerhead kind of evidence that God doesn't exist. If I can convince a Christian who claims to have experienced the Holy Spirit and knows who God is, that there is no God, it can only be because God actually doesn't exist. And they've never experienced God's Spirit. And so, and then they can wipe the sweat from their brow, their forehead, and say, "Whew, I'm safe. There really isn't a God." See what I mean? I just proved it by proving this Christian doesn't actually believe in God anymore. If God really exists and he really knew God, he could never be deconverted. So because I deconverted him, that proves I'm right. There is no God after all. And I think a lot of them are looking for that kind of confirmation in their engagements with Christians, but they'll never get that from me. And unfortunately, I think they have gotten it from a couple of people. Every once in a while, somebody deconverts from Christianity and jumps bandwagon into the atheist camp. And I think that's just the work of Satan, you know, pulling somebody away from Christ and using that as a tool to spur on atheists in their lives.
Yeah, I think you talked, I don't know if it was a recent debate, but I saw a debate. You were talking to a young lady. She was relatively attractive, dark hair. And she said she was a believer at one point.
Yes.
And she had nothing to say with your arguments. It was such a, you know, easy win. You know, you were patient with her, but you just spoke the truth. And I felt sorry for her because she had really nothing to say. You know?
She left the hangout without saying a word. She just left. I remember that. It was about a month and a half ago, I think. She was saying that the Bible was just made up, the New Testament was fabricated, you know, there's no fulfilled prophecy. I told her, well, one of the proofs that the scriptures are the inspired word of God, God exists, is because of fulfilled prophecy. It's irrational to believe that human beings could know the future with high details centuries in advance, you know, so many times. I mean, where is this knowledge coming from in the Bible? It's because it's supernaturally inspired. And her argument was, well, that's not true, that can't be true, blah, blah. And the argument against was, well, the New Testament, the apostles, they just got together and they conspired. They made up these things to make it look like the Old Testament prophecies were fulfilled in Jesus Christ. And, of course, my argument to that was I gave a sound argument for why we should know. We can know that the apostles did not conspire to fabricate the story of the events of Jesus' life, because it's utterly preposterous to believe that. And they gave this long argument, and about halfway through that argument, I guess I was speaking for about 2-3 minutes, and pointing out the absurdity of believing these men could have pulled it off, and much less would have even attempted to. And the case was so strong that she just didn't say another word and left the hangout.
Yeah.
It just shut her right down.
That was a really powerful moment. I remember that clearly. You gave the prophet, because that, everybody has to admit, that is an incredibly powerful argument for the divine nature of the Bible, that over 300 predictions about one guy written before he came, and they all came true. The odds on that are more than there are atoms in the universe.
Absolutely.
When you press that sheet, I mean, she had no answer. Now, we're winding down here, Evan. I got two more questions. What is the most outrageous thing you've seen or heard an atheist do in one of these dialogues or these rational exchanges? I don't know if you have a story that might come to mind that you want to share and tell folks how to handle such things.
A particular one doesn't come to mind, but I think the most extreme examples of some of the things that I've seen is people resorting to blasphemy and to talking about things that are very explicitly, that are just, you know, completely inappropriate. You know, just becoming a savage and ape-like person and being as offensive as possible. That's happened a few times. And I think that's just an example of somebody who absolutely hates God and angry that the Christian is able to give an account for their faith in them. And then finding nothing more that they can do except, you know, just be as offensive and filthy as they can, thinking that that's some kind of a way to win an argument. The truth is, what we're looking for is to show people that these false arguments put forth by Muslims and atheists and evolutionists don't stand up to the truth of Christianity, and we can trust that Jesus Christ is who he says he was, and we have a Savior who loves us and wants us to be with him in paradise. That's the purpose of it, to undo the damage that the world does by standing up for the truth.
Are you still there?
Yes, I'm here.
Okay. I had a little cutout here, but I heard the end of that. My last question is basically two questions, actually. What is your favorite Bible verse? And your YouTube channel is accessible and educational. Do you have any plans for further outreach? Are you just basically going to keep debating folks? Because we need people like you to do that. Is that what you're thinking? And is there anything else that you would want to add to that?
Well, I would like to take my apologetics outdoors instead of just in Google Hangouts and chat rooms on the internet and making videos on the internet. I would like to get a video camera and interview people and ask people questions try to influence their thinking, outdoors, you know, just stop strangers maybe and say, hey, do you mind talking to me a second? I'm doing a little video for YouTube about religion. Have you heard that? You know, and start a little thing there, and then get their mind to start banging around, thinking about what something they've heard that can't be true. Or that being able to hear a strong argument or a point from me. What was the first question that you asked again?
That would be great. That would be great if you do that. I'll pray for you on that issue to be able to have time and the ways and means to do that. And the other question was, what is your favorite Bible verse?
Oh, yes, my favorite Bible verse. I don't know that I have a favorite. One that's really tickled my fancy a lot in the last few months that really gets to me is when Jesus was approached. I think the most profound passage, let me say, one of them, is that the passage, I wish I could quote it directly. I should be able to quote it if it's one of my favorites. It was borrowed by the U.S. Postal Service many, many years ago. Something about neither rain nor sleet nor gloom of night can keep us from our appointed rounds. What they did is they took a Bible verse and they twisted it. The passage which says, nothing can keep us from the love of God, which is found in Jesus Christ. I think that's a really beautiful and powerful passage. I love that one. But one that I've really been enjoying lately is the Pharisees came to Jesus, and they, as they did many times, tried to trip him up and, you know, get him to tell a funny story or make people laugh at him. They tried to trip him up, and they said, what do you think about, Jesus said to them, what do you think about the Messiah? Whose son is he? Jesus responded. He said, well, David said, if the Lord said unto my Lord, sit at my right hand till I make thine enemies my footstool. And Jesus asked him, if David called him Lord, whose son is he? And the Pharisees were dumbfounded by this. They just didn't know what to say, so they didn't say a thing. And the scripture says they didn't ask him any more questions after that. He just put them in their place. So the point of that passage really is that the son that you see, the Old Testament states that the Messiah would be a son of David. And in Hebrew, a son of doesn't mean the direct child of. It could mean a great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-grandson. You know, a son of can be any number of generations down the, I am a son of somebody, you know, in some centuries ago. And so that's what it means by that, to be a son of David. The Messiah would come from the lineage of King David is what that means, that the Messiah would be a son of David. And the Pharisees and the Sadducees knew this, as that the Bible said that the Messiah would be an offspring of King David. So when Jesus said, if David calls him Lord, whose son is he? David is calling the one that's going to be born from his lineage, calls him Lord. Now, if he's Lord, David is praying to him. See, what this all points out is that this man yet to be born is the Messiah, but he's God. He's divine. He's not just a Messiah. He's God in the flesh, that he's is a divine entity. And that's what really stumped them, because if the Lord said unto my Lord, when David says, the Lord said unto my Lord, the Lord, meaning the Lord God, says unto my Lord, which is the Messiah. You see? So we have a conversation in the Trinity right there. The Father says to the Son, sit at my right hand till I make thine enemies my footstool. Right? So if David is calling, if the Lord is talking to my Lord, see, David didn't have any rulers on earth. He was a king of Israel right under God. God was his only direct authority. He wasn't ruled over by any other nation. David's only authority was God Almighty, right? So he answered only to God. And so if David is saying the Lord, he's talking about the Lord God Almighty, said to my Lord, that's a separate one. Who is that? Well, that's the Messiah. So the Father says to my Son, and both of them are divine, you see. So I really like that one, because it points out not only the divinity of Jesus Christ, but it points out that that Jesus Christ was, as a Christian should be able to just nip it in the bud, like Barney Fife would say. You have the arguments, you have the truth, you have, it's all on your side, and you can shut down any false argument if you know the right response.
I'm so glad, Evan, that you brought that scripture up. That was amazing. I could see God's plan in this discussion, because what I wanted a lot of my viewers to get out of this is to see that they can have a boldness, that they don't have to take all this nonsense from unbelievers, and that you're kind of the one of the folks that we can really look to see how to do that properly. And, of course, the main one we look to is Jesus. He stultified all these guys all the time, and he didn't take all their nonsense. And so that's a good way to wrap it up. But I would encourage all my viewers to go over to Evan's channel, Nephilim Free, on YouTube, subscribe, hit the notification button if you can, share his videos, because I'm telling you, his videos are very powerful, because he goes right at it. He doesn't back down. He stands for the truth. He comes at them from many, many different ways, and it's a really powerful ministry. Evan, I'm just so blessed to meet you tonight and so glad that you were with us tonight. If you have any trouble with your recording, let me know, and I can send you one myself, but it'll be on my Facebook channel, as well as my YouTube channel, tomorrow.
Great, Mike. Thank you so much. I'm blessed to have been interviewed by you. It's been great to meet you. You know, it's a blessing to me. Thank you so much.
You bet. I hope we can do it again soon.
Yeah, sure. Let's do it sometime.
God bless you, my friend. Have a blessed day.
Thank you. You too, sir.